So earlier in my career, a student came to me to complain that at the end of a lesson, when I'd asked them to label up the tubes that they'd been using, she'd written her name on a sticker, placed it onto her test tube, and her name had disappeared again. And I asked her to show me the pen that she'd been using, and it turned out it was one of these new at the time style of friction pens. And I worked out pretty quickly, it must be a thermochromic ink that they've got here. When I investigated a little bit further, it turned out that this ink disappears at around 65 Celsius. But you can actually reverse that process, make the ink come back again at about minus 5 by putting it in a freezer. So that I thought there are all kinds of applications that we could have for this kind of thermochromic technology. In the past, we've actually looked at using this as a temperature indicator when we were microwaving some solvents to determine whether or not they had got hot. And today we're going to look at two other examples that we can use this kind of ink for. One, an alternative to the classic marshmallow in a microwave demonstration to determine the speed of light. And second, a bit of a teaching life hack that I've developed to help me with my marking. So let's jump on in. So most people are probably going to be familiar with the old determining the speed of light using marshmallows or chocolate in a microwave. But just in case you aren't, the general idea is that you have an array of microwavable foodstuffs, so marshmallows, chocolate, something that can melt. And you're going to put it into the microwave. Specifically, having turns the plate that's inside the microwave upside down. So inside every microwave, we have a plate like this, and that rotates. The idea being that inside the microwave, there in the cavity there, there's going to be a standing wave set up of microwave radiation, and that some parts of the food, if it's not rotated, will get hot because they're going to be lined up alternatively either with a node or an anti-node. Okay, so some parts are going to get hot, some parts are going to stay cool. So you want to rotate the food to make sure that it's evenly being heated. If we flip the plate upside down so that the plate does not rotate anymore, we can then actually heat up some of our marshmallows, not some others, and actually measure the distance from one hot spot to another, and from that determine the speed of light. So we'll have a look at what that looks like, and I'm going to show you how potentially you might improve on this methodology using one of these pens. So you take your array of marshmallows, you pop them in. I'm just going to be heating here until and checking every sort of 5 to 10 seconds to see whether the marshmallows are heating up in one spot or another. Okay, so let's take a look at what we have here. I've got my array of marshmallows, and it might be tricky to see that here there's some melting taking place on this edge over here. We've got some melting that's taken place just in this sort of spot here. This marshmallow over here has got a little bit warmer and expanded a bit, but it's not that sort of convincing. And we realize that, first of all, we have a problem with sort of determining, are we looking from one antinode to the next, which would be half a wavelength, or are we looking at a complete wave? Now, I know from experience that if I'm looking at this kind of distance in the microwave, that's gonna be one complete wave, but will that be obvious to a student? Perhaps not, okay? Really, we ought to be seeing perhaps that there should be sort of a hot spot in this sort of central point here. I've got about 13 centimeters, give or take, but there's quite a broad range of values that I could take for my wavelength coming through here. And it's not easy for me to justify that I'm actually looking at a complete wave rather than half a wave. I can perhaps, if I'm lucky, take a measurement over to this point again, because I know that I should be looking for a hotspot somewhere around here. This kind of also agrees with my sort of 13 centimeters. So I've got sort of two measurements of 13 centimeters, roughly, but it's quite difficult for me to be much more precise than that. So we have an issue with resolution. We have an issue with the fact that actually this is quite a small plate compared to the size of the cavity of the microwave. And we also have an issue with the fact that the more material we actually put into the microwave, the more we're going to distort the waveform that can potentially form within the cavity. So one way around this is to get yourself a piece of paper, and what I've done here is just scribbled on this piece of paper with some of this thermochromic ink. And may not be true for every single microwave, but certainly for the microwave that I have here, the actual width of the cavity is actually the exact, or almost exactly the same as the length of a sheet of A4 paper. So I've taken in a sheet of A3 paper here, and just made a mark for the depth of the oven, marked it off, trimmed it to size, and scribbled over it with my thermochromic ink. And let's see what kind of a difference we can get in terms of the measurements that we can pull out from our experiment. So I've got all my marshmallow mess cleaned up now. We'll pop the piece of paper into the microwave, and again, so we're getting the full benefit of the edge-to-edge cavity from within the microwave, and a very small amount of mass. Let's see what kind of results we can get and how quickly we can get them. So I'm gonna just pop this in. This is a 1200 watt oven. I find that sort of 5 second bursts, I can sort of stick my nose in and see what kind of patterns are forming, and keep an eye on it that way. So let's have a look. Now, I wouldn't necessarily do this in front of a class just yet, but just to show you what's happening. Immediately, 5 seconds, we have our first spot that's appearing as our hot spot. So at this point, I might actually mark this one off just to get an idea of where the center of that spot was. Let's just grab a pencil. And so I've got one spot here. Let's develop this a little bit further. Are we getting, there is no indications of any other spots appearing just yet. Okay, now this turns out to be quite lovely, so I'm going to mark off here, mark off here, here, and we've got another spot here, and there's perhaps a spot there, but it's not that clear to me. And so already, sort of a couple of seconds, we've got some very fine resolution spots that are appearing, that from which we can take some measurements. So I'm going to mark these up in a slightly fatter pen so they can appear on camera a little bit better, and then we'll see what kind of outcome we get from those. Okay, so hopefully you can see the resolution with which we're able to actually sort of get some measurements coming off from our thermochromic ink. Now I'm going to actually go for some center-to-center measurements. And the other nice thing about this, of course, is that you can photocopy this and pass it around so that students can take their own measurements and make some maximum/minimum values so they can actually come up with some confidence intervals within which they would expect their speed of light to be. So I'll measure these up and get back to you in a couple of seconds. Okay, so I've taken my measurements and I've gone for 7.5 centimeters here, 7 centimeters, and 8 centimeters here, measuring to the nearest half centimeter using the ruler. I've also noted that we've got this reading here at about 11.5 centimeters, but this is a point where we can say, well, these values here sort of seem to agree with each other within a centimeter. This one seems to be a little bit further out. And if we look at the maximum minimum range of values that we could measure from this point on the spot here to over here, we find that actually we're up into the 14 plus range centimeter as our maximum value for the distance between these two spots. That's an ideal point to bring in. Well, are we actually measuring the same thing here between these further spots as we were between these nearer spots? And from there we can perhaps bring in this idea that we got half wavelengths and full wavelengths that we could perhaps be measuring. So I've taken these three values, averaged them out, that gives me 7.5 centimeters. And by taking the reading from the frequency on the back of the microwave oven, we can see that this oven is operating at 2450 megahertz. So that's 2450 times 10 to the 6 hertz. And from speed being equal to frequency times wavelength, that would give us a speed of light for the microwaves in this oven as being 3.7 times 10 to the 8 meters per second. Now, from there, we could perhaps even say, well, is it possible that we could include this 11.5 figure and maybe even take some more measurements to improve our value? Because we know that the real value, true value, of course, we want to compare to is 3.0 times 10 to the 8 meters per second. So when we factor this one in, actually that would bring our value down to sort of 3.5 times 10 to the 8 meters per second. And then, of course, you know, if you've got a larger class, you can actually start handing out some other patterns. So here's some ones I made earlier. And it turns out, actually, at least with this oven, as you repeat more and more, we tend to converge on 3.5 times 10 to the 8 meters per second as being the speed that we're getting up from here. So although we have sort of tuned in and reduced our random errors, we seem to have locked in on that 3.5 figure, suggesting that we have some kind of a systematic error, be that to do with the shape of the waveform that we're looking at in this particular wave cavity, the two-dimensional nature of the wave versus the sort of one-dimensional thing that we were sort of imagining when we're explaining to students. And of course, at this point, you now have your maximum and minimum values between which your true speed could lie, and you have the ability to now actually talk about systematic error versus random error, as well as confidence intervals in your appreciation of the true value. So in the case that I've used with this oven, I find that actually the true speed of light, 3.0 times 8 times 10 to the 8 meters per second, actually lies within the confidence intervals that I've actually been able to map out based on the maximum and minimum values associated with my half wavelength figures. So that's one thing that you can do with this kind of ink. The final thing that actually that I've sort of started using in the last year or two, it's been to do with marking. So I'm going to push this stuff aside and just show you what you might get for a typical exam script. Now, we know that students tend to look, perhaps when you give them back exam scripts, they just tend to look for marks and maybe ignore any comments that you might make on those. In fact, Dylan William often says that, you know, the best person to actually mark a test is the person who just actually wrote the test. But sometimes you may be required, of course, by school to actually do a formal marking exercise on an exam script, a mock, for example, but you still want students to actually learn from the experience. So this is where I worked out how useful these pens can be, because actually what I want my students to be able to do is actually get together, again as recommended by Dylan William, get together and agree a best possible answer to any one of the particular questions that they've been asked, benefiting from the peer tutoring effect, and then have a look at the mark scheme, compare their best possible answers against that one, benefiting from the sort of hyper-correction effect, before they can then actually go back and perhaps sort of see my comments, which we know from evidence suggests they don't actually look at unless you've actually made them engage with the work beforehand, make them go hunting for their feedback. Now, in the past, let's say, for example, I was marking something, I wanted to actually sort of tick things off as I was going through because I wanted to actually help myself keep count. But the problem was that then I needed to kind of erase all of my marking to stop students from just lazily looking at where I had already given the marks. And this is where these pens are such a valuable addition to my toolkit, because now I can actually go through and mark an entire set of scripts, pop them into the oven set to about 80 degrees to make sure that they're well above that sort of 65 degree transition temperature, and all of my marking disappears. Then I can hand the students back their scripts. They can, in pencil, make their own comments, improvements to their answers, and compare with the mark scheme. And only then, when they've sort of provided me with evidence that they've really engaged with the level of feedback that I'm expecting from them, then they earn the right to get back from me what I thought, you know, my marks were And they can compare for that final sort of comparison and improvement point by just taking my scripts and sticking them back into the freezer to have all of my marking come back. Of course, when they're doing their marking, they need to be using pencil or something that's going to be different from what they've written in. And it's really important, of course, when they're doing their writing in the first place, that they're not using thermochromic pens themselves, which, of course, can make this whole exercise a real pain in the neck. So give it a try. It's something that works really well for me, and my students enjoy it too. So worthwhile giving it a try.